So, I don't know if you were here last week, some of you here last week, and last week Alison spoke. Don't forget, if you can't come, don't forget, I'll say this again, if you're ever not able to come, and we can't always be together for different reasons, we're away, working, whatever, not well, whatever it might be, you can always catch up on our YouTube. That's why we record, and that's why every week, by about tea time, normally the service, well, certainly the message, maybe a song, is on our YouTube. We do encourage people to do that and share it, maybe, if there's a message there that you know might be able to pass on and somebody else might appreciate. So do use our YouTube channel and our Facebook page and our church website and all those things that we try and still use as a church to reach people. But last week, Alison spoke and she told us in John 4 that it says that Jesus had to go through Samaria. And when she said that word had to, when you look at the kind of the origins of where it says that in John 4, what she was saying is there was an intentionality. It was Jesus intentionally had to go through Samaria. And she said that because there was this divine appointment waiting there for him. And so that's why he had to go. And Jesus, obviously Alison explained all about that and then expanded on the story of when Jesus, as he went through Samaria, stopped at a well and had this amazing encounter with this lady. And her life was turned around and changed. Now this week, I want to share a group of stories that I kind of like. But they all have something in common. And in some ways, they all come from a different direction to last week's Bible story. That's why I started there. So maybe, the challenge is, I don't think it's too difficult, can you spot the difference? All right, so think about this story last week with Jesus intentionally going through Samaria so that he has this encounter with this woman at the well. This week, a group of stories, but they come from a slightly different direction. Can you spot it? The first story is the story of Zacchaeus. A lot of you will know the story of Zacchaeus. I want to just read to you the first four verses of Zacchaeus. It says this. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was. But being a short man, he could not because of the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. Lots of us will know the story of Zacchaeus. Jesus is entering Jericho. Zacchaeus, this man, wants to see Jesus. But there's a bit of an issue. And the issue is there's this big crowd, and we're told that Zacchaeus is very small, and you can imagine him, I can't see over the crowd, it's several deep, and I can't see what's going on. But he has this great idea, and he goes and climbs a tree, a sycamore tree. And I reckon lots of you, if I really wanted to, we could get the old Sunday school going, couldn't we? Nah, I know that's not doing it. Now, here's a question. Apparently the question is, why did Zacchaeus want to see Jesus? It's possibly that he wanted to see Jesus just out of curiosity. He was kind of following the crowd, I suppose. The crowd were going, he was following the crowd. What we don't know is what Zacchaeus had already heard about Jesus. So he was going to see Jesus, but we're not sure what he knew about Jesus at that point. What we also don't know is, did Zacchaeus already at that point know that he had made mistakes? That his life was not what he wanted it to be? Did he know that already? See, we know that he was working for the Romans as a tax collector. And by being a tax collector working for the Romans, he was cheating his own people. We know that. But was at this stage, did he understand that he'd made mistakes? Did he realize that, actually, you know what, my life is not great? Was he perhaps even already carrying some shame in him, some guilt in him because of that. Perhaps he just didn't feel good about himself. We don't know, is the honest answer at that stage. Did he know that he needed forgiveness? Did he know when he climbed that tree that he wanted a new start, that he wanted a chance to change? And did he hope that this was something that could be found in Jesus? Like I say, we're not sure. But what we do know is that Zacchaeus went looking for Jesus, and in Jesus, that is what he found. See, we know the story. Zacchaeus is in the tree, Jesus is walking by, Jesus spots him in the tree, and Jesus kind of invites himself around to Zacchaeus' house for tea, during which we discover that Zacchaeus finds acceptance, he finds forgiveness, he finds a new start, his life is totally, totally changed. Zacchaeus went looking for Jesus. Zacchaeus in him carried mistakes. He was doing wrong. What did he know about that? What did he feel about that? As he approaches, we're not sure, but what we know that when he found Jesus in that encounter space, he found acceptance and forgiveness, a new start. His life was totally changed. So that's the first story. The second story that I want to just think about is the story of the woman who had, we're told, had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. You can find it in Matthew 9, Mark 5, Luke 8. You can find this story in the Bible. So we're told that this woman had been bleeding internally for 12 years. And I'm sure that over those 12 years, this woman must have tried everything. In fact, in Mark's account, Jesus tells us that she had seen many doctors. Can we please turn up for a moment? I'm going to get more like an umpire, I guess. A snooker, right? Okay. In Mark's account, it tells us that this woman, she'd seen many doctors. She'd spent all that she had. But instead of getting better, we're told that she grew worse. She must have been desperate. After 12 years, she must have been desperate to be healed. I've said already that this story is in three of the Gospels. And in each of the accounts, we read that this woman went looking for Jesus. We're also told that to get to Jesus, she had to push her way through the crowd. Again, a bit like Zacchaeus, I suppose, in some ways, a crowd around him, and she was desperate, and she had to push her way through to get to Jesus. And you know, when I read that, you know, sometimes there are barriers that get in the way of us getting to Jesus. And these barriers can come in all kinds of shapes and sizes. They can be barriers that we put up ourselves. They can, you know, in our own kind of emotions and our own conversations and our own ways of doing it, we can put barriers up to get to Jesus. The world can put barriers up that means it be stored to get to Jesus. Other people around us can sometimes kind of put these barriers up that mean we struggle sometimes to get to Jesus. We're told that this woman, there was a crowd, but she wanted to get to Jesus. She'd been bleeding for 12 years. She'd tried everything else. Nothing had worked. She was getting worse. She had to push through the crowd, but we're told that when she touched Jesus' cloak, she was healed. And it says, and I really like this, she was freed from her suffering. I wonder who fancies a bit of that today. When this woman touched Jesus' cloak, she was healed. And she was freed from her suffering. Amazing, isn't it? And then there's Nicodemus. Like I said, a little group of stories today. You could preach on more, probably lots in there, but I'm just kind of grouping these stories together today. There's this guy called Nicodemus. You find the story of Nicodemus in John 3. And Nicodemus was a Pharisee. He was a member of the Jewish ruling council at the time. And we're told that he came to see Jesus at night. And we kind of understand that he came at night because he just didn't want to be seen. You know, he didn't want to be seen by the other Pharisees, guys, and we get a lot of flack for that. Get into trouble. Different reasons, you can go into it in great detail. But we're told that Nicodemus came to Jesus, but he came to him at night. But he knew there was something about Jesus, because you read in John 3, verse 2, these words. He came to Jesus at night and said, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the signs you are doing if God were not with him." So he came to Jesus at night, but he already kind of knew there was something about Jesus because he'd obviously heard stuff and seen stuff. But I believe that when you read the account of Nicodemus in John 3, I believe that he came looking for Jesus because actually he was searching for truth. And in his conversations with Jesus, well, there's some great conversation he has with Jesus. You get some great replies from Jesus in the conversation. Some things that we hold that lovely today. You know, so for example, so in John 3, Nicodemus at night, he's searching for truth, he goes to find Jesus. You know, so we get replies like in verse 3 when Jesus says, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again." That's in his conversation with Jesus. And then John 3, verse 16, okay, this is in the conversation with Nicodemus. We know it well, don't we? "For God, soul of the world," this is Jesus talking to Nicodemus, "that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish and shall have eternal life." Let's just carry on a little bit. "For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already because he has not believed in the name of God, the God's one and only Son." So in Nicodemus coming to Jesus, he gets some great stuff from Jesus in the conversation that he has with him. Stuff that we hold today as the church. See, Nicodemus coming to Jesus at night, I think searching for truth, I think Nicodemus heard the truth. And he saw the truth in his encounter with Jesus. He heard the truth and he saw the truth when he met Jesus. Another story for you. We'll go back to some of these stories in a minute. But another story from Luke 7 is the woman who pours perfume on Jesus' feet. Again, a lot of you know these stories quite well. It's fine. So we're told in Luke 7 that Jesus is dining at a Pharisee's house. We're told that enters a woman or a sinful woman. And we kind of have ideas what that might mean. She has with her an alabaster jar of perfume, which actually is very expensive. Her tears, we're told, wet Jesus' feet. She wipes them away with her hair and she pours perfume onto his feet. The people around are not happy at all. Lots of reasons. Woman, sinful, touching Jesus, pouring expensive perfume, all these kinds of things. And in that space, Jesus takes it as an opportunity to teach those that are there. And he says, "Look, you know, who's happy when the biggest debt's done?" So, you know, if you've got a little debt and somebody forgives you of that debt, or you've got a massive debt and somebody forgives you, who would be the one that's most happy? And they go, "Well, obviously the one with the bigger debt." Yeah, Jesus, yeah, that's the woman. Yeah, that's why, you know, Jesus is doing a bit of teaching in there. But again, this woman, I love it. Again, it's the story of her pushing her way through to get to Jesus. And we could talk about forgiveness in her, and we could talk about her value and acceptance in Jesus. But you know what I want to talk about, or what I want to highlight, is that when she pushed her way to Jesus, and she... her tears and her hair and perfume. For me, when she pushed her way through to Jesus, there was this beautiful act of worship, of honour, and of devotion. She went to Jesus, and in that space, She worshipped. She worshipped him. She honored him. Her devotion was fully towards him. So one more story. Slightly different angle. It's about the story of the friends who lower a paralyzed man through the roof. Again, some of you know the story well, and if you don't, it's in Luke 5. The story is this. Jesus is teaching in a home. Lots of people around. He's teaching the people that are there. And some men arrive, and they're carrying another man who is paralyzed. They want to get their friend, this man, before Jesus. But again, there's a problem. There are too many people around. They can't get in the house. Once again, we see sometimes a barrier to get to Jesus. This time it's a physical barrier again of all the people that are there. They want to get their friend to Jesus. Oh man, he's in this little house. How do we get him? How do we get our friend to Jesus? What do? Well, they climb onto the roof. They use their initiative. And then they lower their friend down through the roof before Jesus. In front of Jesus, this man who's paralyzed finds forgiveness and he finds healing. Jesus says to him, get up and walk. Now this story is slightly different to the others that I've already told, because in this story it was the man's friends who brought him to Jesus. So I want to say this to you. Do whatever it takes to get those you know, to get those you love, to get those you care about before Jesus. I say that again. Do whatever it takes to get those you know, those you love, those you care about before Jesus. You know, in John 1, it says this, verses 41 to 42, this is a kind of the calling of the early disciples. And it says this, the first thing that Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, we found the Messiah, that is the Christ. And he brought him to Jesus. So the first thing that Andrew does when he finds Jesus on this beach, you know, as Jesus is bringing his disciples together, is he goes and he tells his brother, and he goes and gets his brother, and he says, you have now got to come and see the man that I know, that's met me. And he brings, in the Bible, it just says he brings his brother, or he brings his brother to Jesus. And then some of the, you know, people write about verses in the Bible, or commentate on them, and I love the commentary on this verse, and it says, you know, when Andrew brought his brother Simon to Jesus, it was the greatest thing that one man can render another. I love that. The greatest thing that a person can do for another person is bring them before Jesus. Do whatever you can to get those you love, those you care about, before Jesus. So, let's bring it in. Did you see the connection? Did you see what all the stories had in common? Did you spot the difference to last week's story? Did you? I hope so. I hope it wasn't too complicated. But last week, Jesus went somewhere to have that encounter, didn't he, with that woman at the well. These were all stories of people who fought their way through, who had to get, who came to Jesus. They came to him. Zacchaeus and the woman who was bleeding and the woman, they all came to Jesus. And that's my message today, because my title of my message is just simply this, and I do title my messages, it just says, I've got to get to Jesus. That's the title, it's simple. Like Zacchaeus, you know, we don't know, but somewhere in that county, he knew he messed up, he knew he needed forgiveness, there was probably some shame and guilt because of the things that he was doing. He was, you know, hurting his own people. He was stealing from his own people. But he knew he had to get to Jesus, because Jesus was the one where he could find forgiveness. Jesus was the one where he could have that new start, a chance to change. It was found in Jesus. And that's for us today. If you are not, if you are carrying with you the mistakes that you carry, or the shame that you might carry, or the things that you've done, all I can do is encourage you to come to Jesus. In a short time, we're going to take communion. A place where we remember the sacrifice that Jesus made for our mistakes and our sin. Come to Jesus. What about that woman who was bleeding for 12 years, tried everything, but somehow pushed her way through the crowd just to touch the cloak of Jesus. And in that moment, she was healed and she was set free from her suffering. Maybe today, some of you need some healing. It could be a physical thing. It could be healing emotionally, because we know we carry emotional hurt. It could be spiritually you need healing. Maybe you have to push past some barriers, but what I want to say to you is, come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Reach out to him again. You know, you might have to physically touch his, you know, he's not walking past me, physically touch his cloak, but I believe his spirit is here and we can reach him and we can touch his presence. Maybe you're like Nicodemus. I think Nicodemus was just searching for truth. He had that hole in him that we sometimes talk about. You know, he had that, something is missing, I need the truth. So many people are like that, aren't they? And we know that the world around us will offer so many alternatives to the truth. But in the end, we remember that Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. It's Jesus. The truth is in Jesus. He is the truth. If you're searching for truth, you're not going to find it in possessions. You're not going to find it in relationships. You're not going to find it in alcohol, whatever. And I'm not saying all these things are bad, because, you know, relationships are good and family. But in the end, truth is in Jesus, because he is the truth. He's the one that deeply fulfills us, satisfies that hunger. He's the bread of life. What about that woman who pours perfume on Jesus' feet? You know, that challenges me, because the question I've got in my notes is this. What length will we go to give Jesus our worship, our devotion, our honor? And what would it cost us? Because if I'm honest, I think in the church today, and I don't just mean this church, I think we take it too, it's not, turn them when I turn them all, do put God in when I want. We come casual. And this woman who just comes broken, and just, I just want to honour Jesus, because he's the one that deserves our praise, our honour, our worship more than anything else. And yes, sometimes to do that, it will cost us something. Time, energy, money, I don't know, but it might cost us something. But it's Jesus, and he deserves it. And finally, that friend of the paralyzed man. What can we do to get those we care about love before Jesus? These friends that were so desperate to get their friend before Jesus, they were prepared to climb a roof, whatever they had to do to get this, their friend down before Jesus, because they wanted their friend to meet Jesus and knew that in Jesus, he's the one who heals, he's the one that forgives, he's the one who changes lives, he can do it. And they did it all that they could to get their friend. How far would we go? And we said, well, I did ask him to come to church once. Yeah, that's lovely. Yeah, that's, I value that. How much do we love those who we love who don't know Jesus, in the way that we want them to know Jesus? What stirs in us to say, oh, whatever it can take, God, I want to get it before you. We sing a song sometimes, don't we? Called Graves into Gardens. And it says, you turn mourning to dancing, you give beauty for ashes, you turn shame into glory, and then it says, you're the only one who can. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can. I stand here today as someone that just thinks, just stirred again. It's not about getting people to me, to church. I just want to get people to Jesus. Because he's the only one that can do this stuff. He's the only one that can properly heal people deeply. He's the only one that can forgive people, give new chances. He's the only one that can do this stuff that the world can't do. He can transform lives. He can restore hope. He can bring peace. He can give eternal life. He's the only one that can do it. I'm a Christian and I follow Christ. It's about him. He has to be. He's the only one. I just want to encourage people to come to Jesus. Not come to me, come to church, come to the coffee morning. Over everything else, it's about getting people. That we do all those things, and they're good things, but they're things that have to be centered on, in the end, wanting to get people to Jesus. Because he's the only one who can. Set free. Heal, restore, break the chains that the world puts around people. I just want to see more of that. You up for a bit of that?
Yeah.
I'm glad it does it for me, and I need to come to it all the time. But I want to get some more people in there as well. But today we're going to move into communion in a minute. And, you know, communion, just an invitation again, isn't it, to come forward, take communion, these bits of bread, a little bit of juice. But in the end, it's an invitation to come to Jesus. You're not coming to a table, you're not coming to a piece of bread, you're coming to Jesus. If you've got something today, bring it to Jesus, all right? But before we do that, we're going to sing, and we're going to sing.
Treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together, and every desire is now satisfied. Cause the God